there, Jerry. What do you hear what he say?
Hello, Rocky. How do you feel?
Like a million. How's Soapy and the kids?
Pulling for you all the way. As long as there's the slightest hope from the governor.
It'd be a whole lot easier to handle me out of the way, won't they?
That's up to you, Rocky.
Huh?
We haven't got a lot of time. I want to ask you one last favor.
There's not much else that I can do, kid.
Yes, there is, Rocky. Perhaps more than you could do under any other circumstances. If you have the courage for it, and I know you have.
Me walking in there? That's not going to take much.
I know that, Rocky.
Am I sitting in a barber chair? They're going to ask me, got anything to say? And I say, sure. Give me a haircut, a shave, and a massage. One of those nice new electric massages.
But you're not afraid, Rocky?
No, they'd like me to be, wouldn't they? But I'm afraid I can't oblige them, kid. You know, Jerry, I think in order to be afraid, you got to have a heart. I don't think I got one. I had that cut out of me a long time ago.
Suppose I asked you to have the heart. To be scared.
What do you mean?
Suppose at the last minute the guards dragged you out here screaming for mercy. Suppose you went to the chair yellow.
Yellow? Say, what's the matter with you, Jerry? He's been worrying about my courage.
I know that. This is a different kind of courage, Rocky. The kind that's, well, that's born in heaven. Well, not the courage of heroics or bravado. The kind that you and I and God know about.
Still don't know what you mean.
Look, Rocky, just before I came up here, the boys saw me off on the train, Soapy and several of the others. Well, you can well imagine what they told me. Your father tell Rocky to show the world what he's made of, and tell him not to be afraid, and to go out laughing. And...
What do you want? I'm not going to let them down. That's worrying you.
That's what I want you to do. I want you to let them down. You see, you've been a hero to these kids and hundreds of others all through your life. And now you're going to be a glorified hero in death, and I want to prevent that, Rocky. They've got to despise your memory. They've got to be ashamed of you.
You asked me to pull an act, turn yellow, so those kids will think I'm no good. You asked me to throw away the only thing I got left, the only thing I've been able to take away from me. You want me to give those newspaper substitutes a chance to stay another act turn yellow.
But, Rocky, you and I all know that you're not.
You're asking a nice little favor, Jerry. Ask me to crawl on my belly, last thing I do in life.
I know what I'm asking. And the reason I'm asking is because being kids together sort of gave me the idea that you might like to join hands with me and save some of those other boys from ending up here.
Nothing, Don. You're asking too much. You want to help those kids? You got to figure out some other way.
It's impossible to do it without your help, Rocky. I can't reach all of those boys. Thousands of hero-worshipping kids all over the country.
Oh, don't give me that in your mind if you stuff again, will you? I had enough of that in the courtroom. Told everything I knew. Name, names. Get the low down, the whole dirty mess. Now, what more do you want?
What I've always wanted, Rocky. Straighten yourself out with God. Outside of that, I can't ask for anything else.
Well, don't.
It's time, Rocky. Are you ready?
Yeah. You think I'm going in with me?
I'd like to, Rocky. That is it.
You can if you wish. Do you mind, Father?
Certainly not.
That's better. I think I'm lost and going down that last mile. Promise me something. Promise me you won't let me hear you pray.
I promise you won't hear me.
You know what, you mean, screw? What's your face?
It'll be the last face you see, big shot, and it'll be the laughing at you.
Don't get near me now, I'll spit in your eye again.
Everett, stand back. Carlson, take care of it.
I don't need anybody. Come on. Not a boy, Rocky. Take your own company.
So long, Rocky. We won't be long.
So long, Rocky.
Please.
Now, I'm not here anymore. My hair is green and I'm a tree.
You ever see anybody this torn up?
Well, it's a cinch he's not strung out on sugar cubes.
Yeah.
All right. Let's take him to central receiving.
Come on, son.
Even if your body does die, your mind will live on.
Yeah, we know. Come on.
You're the dirty disbelievers. The evil disbelievers. Evil! Evil! Evil!
Come on, son. Settle down.
Brown, blue, yellow, green, green, orange, red, 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 red. I can hear them. I can hear them all.
Yeah, sure you can, kid. Let's go back to the office. We'll all listen. Bill and I took the sugar cubes found on the subject to the Scientific Investigation Division located in the police building in downtown Los Angeles. We talked to forensic chemist Ray Murray. We filled him in on the subject's appearance and his behavior pattern.
Tell us about the stuff, Ray.
Visual distortions, strangely disoriented. It's a relatively new drug developed in Switzerland virtually by accident. Swiss biochemist the name of Hoffman came up with the first synthesis of the drug in 1938.
Yeah?
Lysergic acid, diethylamide tartrate, LSD-25.
What's it look like, Ray?
LSD's odorless, colorless, tasteless. Comes in two forms, liquid and powder. I'll run these sugar cubes through, but I can tell you right now, they contain LSD.
4 p.m., Bill and I left the crime lab and headed back toward Georgia Street Juvenile. Before we left him, Ray Murray filled us in on more facts and figures. A kilo of LSD, 2 2/10 pounds, can be divided into 5 to 10 million doses. Murray also gave us one last frightening fact. LSD is so potent that a single pound of the preparation could turn every person in Los Angeles County into a total psychotic. The population of the county, 7 million people. Wednesday, October 5th. 6 months went by. LSD users were increasing at an alarming rate, particularly among juveniles. By now, the users had established their own language. The drug itself was now called the Ticket, the Ghost, the Beast, the Chief, the Hawk, or simply...
Fairly equal terms of warmth, eh, Fettes?
A fine specimen, isn't he, Toddy McFarlane? Come, Toddy, sit down here with me.
Don't call me that confounded name.
Well, then, Dr. McFarlane. Though I've known the time, Toddy, when you like the name. Aye, and many are dead now who called you by it. Rough and wild ones they were, too. But sit down, Toddy, with your friend.
Mr. Fettes and I have professional matters to discuss.
Medicine? That'll keep. Sit down. You wouldn't want it said of you that you refused a glass to an old friend.
We'll buy you a glass, Gray.
I'm a pretty bad fellow myself, but McFarlane's the boy. Oh, Toddy McFarlane. Why don't you order for your friend, Toddy? No, on second thoughts, I'll do the ordering. We'll have a bowl of hot punch and a cup from the loin of that young porter. Oh, don't worry, waiter. I'm with my friend, the great Dr. McFarlane. He wants to sit here with the commonality. You were going to speak of medical matters. Well, don't let my humble presence stop you. Talk on, Toddy.
I will not have you call me by that name.
You will not have it.
Dr. McFarlane, you remember the lady who came to see you yesterday, the lady with the little girl?
I remember.
She came again today and wanted me to ask you if you wouldn't break your rule and operate. She feels that you are her only hope.
So she told me. I'm a teacher, not a practitioner.
A teacher, eh? Maybe you're afraid to be a doctor.
Afraid of what?
Afraid you're not as good a doctor as you make out to be.
I'm the best man for the job.
Why don't you do it, then? I'd like for you to do the operation, Toddy.
You? Since when have you become the protector of little children?
It's not the child I'm concerned with, Toddy. It's you I'm thinking of. I'd like to have you prove that a lot of things I know haven't hurt Toddy McFarlane any.
I'll not do it, Gray.
Oh, yes, you will. You'll do it to oblige Mr. Fettes and myself.
No.
Maybe there's some private reasons between you and me that'll make you. Some long-lost friends, eh, Toddy? Say you'll do it for me and my friend Mr. Fettes here.
It might be an interesting case.
That's a good boy, Toddy.
You only want me to do it because I don't want to. That's it, isn't it, Gray?
Toddy hates me.
Don't call me by that name.
Hear it. Do you ever see the lads play knife?
How much have you, Timmy? 7 shillings is 84 pennies, 168 halfpennies, and 336 farthings.
But there's more folk around the old churchyard than farthings and 7 shillings.
Yes, Ellie, but they're over poor.
But, Tammy, we have to get it. Mr. Train's gone to give him up. He was wearing all his good clothes and a long dress to go to Bobby's burial.
Not if we can get the money first. Sell everybody, Ellie.
Everybody you can find. And I will, too. Every band and grip was, Ellie. And run.
Have you any money to save the wee dog's life?
Well, I'm looking for the man Trail, the case for the dog. Have you seen him?
You can't go in there until the court is in session at 9 o'clock.
Well, I'm a member of the...
That's my order, sir, from the Lord Provost himself.
Provis isn't listed to be here today. I think I'd better wait.
There's many would say this is no much of a case for the Lord Provost to bother his head about, Your Worship.
I must be the judge of that, Mr. Trail. Sergeant McLean has the prisoner in custody, I see. Now, Mr. Trail, the point at issue are very simple. Do you give food and shelter to this dog? And do you own him? Let's take the first point first.
Aye, Your Lordship. I've always fed the wee dog ever since. Well, I've always fed him and I'm no denying it.
Why did you? If he is not your own.
Well, at first, to ease my conscience, because I blame myself in part for the death of the wee dog's master.
You said at first. What then?
Oh, I've courted the wee terrier for a long, long time since then because of nobody of my own. But he'll hear none of me. Except he's friendly and polite. He just grieves for the old man that's dead.
The law says the dog must have an owner.
And I can't claim to be that, Your Lordship. Because it's no true. But I cannot believe the Lord would make a man abandon his principles and lie, or take the life of a wee dog for a matter of a few shillings and a piece of paper.
The law deals with facts, not with emotions, Mr. Trail. The dog is ownerless.
Is there a case about a wee dog in there?
You can't go in there.
You see, Jeannie, I told you that.
Whisht, man. My husband and I are important witnesses in the case. Is it in there? Where's the dog's owner, sir?
Begging your pardon, Your Lordship, but that's right. That's right.
James Brown, you're telling a lie. He's the caretaker of the kirkyard, Your Lordship, that's so sick at home in bed.
Constable, let these two witnesses in. No one else. You stay outside. Your name?
James Brown, Your Lordship.
You claim ownership of the dog?
Aye, we do.
And we've come to pay the license for him.
My wife has the money here in her purse. We just heard about the dog being taken up, and I thought that...
Yes, yes, Mr. Brown, you're claiming ownership. In that case...
That's not the case at all, Your Lordship. James Brown is not the owner of the dog.
If I pay for him, I am.
You've no legal right to Bobby any more than I.
Mr. Brown, does the dog sleep under your roof?
Well, no, Your Lordship, no at night. No, I cannot say that. He sleeps in the kirkyard.
With the minister's permission, of course.
Well, no, Your Lordship, I cannot say that.
Oh, this is but a wee dog that holds its cob, and it's very respectful.
Aye, and he's only been there such a short time, Your Lordship.
For some months, Mr. Brown. The minister told me that himself.
The minister knows, he told Your Lordship.
He was told by the Bible reader at the funeral. Then by the minister at Colbray, where the dog once lived. And might live now. If you had not fed him every day to keep him here.
Well, the folks at Colbray didn't license him, Your Lordship. Well, there'd be no charge for the lack of it.
I'm paying for Bobby's license myself, John Trail.
He'll do no such thing, James Brown. In all my life, I've never surrendered a principle before, Your Lordship. But the charge is on me, and I'll pay it.
I feel I must point out to you both that the dog sleeps under neither of your roofs. So belongs no more to one than to the other.
I was summoned to license him and be his owner. And I will.
But I ask first.
Perhaps both of you are thinking more of winning an argument than winning the dog. A dog needs a home. But it needs love, too. That more than anything.
Your Lordship, do you think he doesn't get that? Because he most certainly does. Not only from me and my wife, but from every child in Greyfriars. They feel he's one of them.
Your Lordship, do not send him away from the kirkyard. For many of the bairns in Greyfriars, Bobby is the only love.
What are you bairns doing in here? Come on, out of it. Go on, bloody out.
Mister, we're looking for Greyfriars Bobby.
Aye, and Mr. Trail that brought him here.
Are you going out or no? Young savages in the borough court. Have you taken me to your senses?
Your Lordship!
Silence. Close the door.
Look, he's not dead.
Ah!
Will it be all right now, Mr. Trail?
I've got the money for a license and my bonnet, Mr. Trail.
Let you out there, mister.
It's 7 shillings if you wish to count.
But where did you bairns get all this money from?
And how?
Everybody around the country I gave it. To pay the place Dr. Mac Bobby did.
I gave a pound, Mr. Trail.
I knew every bill we asked. I gave a penny.
Everybody gave something.
Yes, we did.
Whisht! Have you no respect for where you are? In the Great Borough Court. Whisht!
Mr. Trail, hand the dog up here. Answer me this, any of you. Do you know what it means to be given the freedom of the city?
Tammy would know, sir. He's a scholar's Harriet School. Now.
It's when the Queen comes, mister. And you give the keys to the bar gates that are not here anymore.
Right, laddie. The gates and walls are down. But we still give the keys to visitors who are grand, or wise, or just useful out of the ordinary.
Like the Duke of Wellington and Miss Florence Nightingale.
Yes, the brave and faithful. Now here's a wee dog that's been faithful out of the ordinary. For a dead man he loved, he's gone hungry and been cold. He has never forgotten him. Or left his side by night.
And do the police now have to take him?
If he's made free of the city, he can wander where he likes.
What would Bobby do with keys?
Give her another as soon as look at her. She ain't forgiven me. Not much. It's this Christian game of yours I want to play up against me. I won't have it, I tell you. So take your money and stop throwing your silly best face up against mine.
Major, may I take a little of it for the army?
No. The army's not to be bought.
Bill.
We want your soul, and we'll take nothing less.
I know. Me and my few bob ain't good enough for you. You're an earl's granddaughter, you are. Nothing less than £100 I'd do for you.
Come, Barbara, you could do a great deal of good with £100. If you'll set this gentleman's mind at ease by taking his pound, I'll give you the other 99.
Oh, Papa, you're too extravagant. Bill offers 20 pieces of silver. All you need offer is the other 10. That'll make the standard price to buy anybody who's for sale. Well, I'm not, and the army's not.
Delighted to see you looking so well, my dear. Why didn't you write and say you was coming? We'd have got something hot for supper.
What's that? That's mine, Fagin.
No, no, my dear. Mine, Bill, mine. You shall have the books.
If that ain't mine, mine and Nancy, that is, I'll take the boy back again. Now, come on, hand over, will you? Where is it?
This is hardly fair, Bill. Hardly fair, is it, Nancy?
Fair or not fair, give it here, you avaricious old skeleton. Give it. Take the books if you're fond of reading. If you ain't, sell them.
Help! Help!
Who's
there? Give him that, Bill. He'll tear the boy to pieces.
Are you right?
No, man.
You'll stand off of me. I'll have to let him.
I don't care. I don't care.
What's the matter here?
The girl's gone mad.
No, she ain't, thank you. No, she ain't. Don't think it.
Then keep quiet, will you?
No, I won't do that neither. What do you think of that?
So you wanted to get away, my dear. Did you, eh? Wanted to get assistance. Called for the police, did you? We'll soon cure you of that, my young monster.
You can't take it. You've got the boy. What more do you want?
Let him be.
Let him be, or I'll put that mark on some of you that'll send me to the gallows before my time.
Why, Nancy, you're more clever than ever tonight. Ha ha! You're acting beautiful, dear.
Am I? Then take care I don't overdo it. You'll be the worse for it, Fagin, if I do.
What do you mean by this? You're a nice one, a pretty subject for the boy to make a friend of.
So help me, I am. I wish I'd been struck dead in the street before lending a hand to bring him here. He's a thief, a liar, a devil, and all that's bad from this night on. Isn't that enough of the old wretch without blows?
Come, come, Sykes, we must have civil words. Civil words, Bill.
Civil words, you villain. Yes, you deserve them from me. I thieved for you when I was a child not half his age. And I thieved for you ever since. Don't you know it?
And if you have, it is your living.
Aye, it is. It is my living. And the cold, wet, dirty streets are my own. And you're the wretch that drove me to them long ago. And little gave me there. Die and night!